This is part 3 of a series on autoencoder. In this video, we will look at a sparse autoencoder. This video was produced in Korean and translated into English. My voice is generated by AI, text-to-speech. First, let's take a look at an overview of a sparse autoencoder and how to impose a sparsity constraint on an autoencoder. Next, let's look at the L1 activity deregularization and KL divergence regularization for a sparsity constraint. Finally, let's implement a sparse autoencoder model to detect edges of MNIST images. Now let's take a look at an overview of a sparse autoencoder. On the left is a simple autoencoder. In standard autoencoders, no constraints are placed on the activations in the hidden layer. Let's assume that the output vector of the encoder for some input is as follows. Just looking at this vector, we cannot guess what the input data looks like. That is, latent vectors are not easily interpretable. However, enforcing a sparsity constraint on the hidden layer's activations allows the network to discover meaningful and interpretable features of the input data. The two models on the right are examples of autoencoders with a sparsity constraint. Only some neurons in this layer are activated, while the rest are inactivated. An activated neuron outputs a value closer to 1, and an inactive neuron outputs a value closer to 0. In this example, the red neurons are active and the white neurons are inactive. Let's say the latent vector is like this. These values are very large compared to the rest. For example, let's say that when an image similar to the digit 5 from MNIST is input, these two neurons are activated, and when an image similar to the digit 8 is input, these two neurons are activated. Then we can guess the shape of the input image just by looking at the latent vector. That is, the latent vector has meaningful and interpretable features for the input data. This can be a great help for neural networks to learn from data. The sparsity constraint can be enforced via L1 activity regularization or KL divergence regularization. An autoencoder with a sparsity constraint is called a sparse autoencoder. Next, let's look at how to impose a sparsity constraint on the autoencoder model. Let's look at a simple autoencoder example below. We have a batch of data of size M containing 5 features. The outputs Q of the encoder for this batch of data are as follows. The number of neurons in the hidden layer is N. We would like to impose a sparsity constraint on this hidden layer. Again, this can be implemented through activity regularization. We can apply L1 activity regularization like this, or we can apply KL divergence regularization like this. L1 regularization can also make Q sparse because it tends to select some Q as we saw in machine learning tutorials. Here, we will look at how to apply KL divergence regularization. This was previously covered in the regularization series for neural networks, but we'll revisit it here. For example, in this neural network, we want to limit the average of the outputs Q to around 0.05. If a neuron's output is 1, we can say it is active. And if its output is 0, we can say it is inactive. That is, the output Q is a Bernoulli random variable. Let the output of the jth neuron in the hidden layer for the ith data point xi be qij. M is the batch size of data. When m pieces of data x are input to the neural network, m pieces of qij are output to the encoder. Let the average of qij be rho hat j. This notation means the value of qij when the data point xi is entered. For example, we want to train this neural network so that rho hat j is around 0.05. Let's call the desired output 0.05 rho. Rho is a sparsity parameter, typically a small value close to zero. That is, we want the average output of each neuron in this hidden layer to be approximately 0.05. For the average to be as small as 0.05, the outputs of this hidden layer must mostly be near zero. This means that the outputs of this hidden layer become sparse. To achieve this, we add a penalty term to the loss function. This penalizes rho hat j that deviates significantly from rho. The following KL divergence can be used as a penalty term. This KL is the Kullback-Leibler divergence between a Bernoulli random variable with mean rho and a Bernoulli random variable with mean rho hat j. Minimizing this makes the distribution of rho and the distribution of rho hat j similar. That is, rho hat j gets closer to rho. So, the regularized loss function is as follows. The source of this content is this document. For more information on this, please refer to this document. Now let's implement a sparse autoencoder using KL divergence regularization. Read the MNIST dataset and split it into training and test data. Next, we write a class that applies KL divergence regularization to the neural network layers. The inputs to this class are lambda, which is a regularization constant, and rho, which is a sparsity parameter. We will set lambda to 0.01 and rho to 0.1. And we write the call method. This method takes as input Q, the outputs of the neural network layer, computes the average values of Q for each neuron in the neural network layer, clips the average values outside the range of 0 and 1, and it calculates the KL divergence using rho and rho hat. Finally, it returns the regularization term. Next, we build a sparse autoencoder model, create an input layer, and create an encoder layer using a 2D convolutional layer. Apply the sparsity constraint class we just created to the activity regularizer argument. Alternatively, L1 activity regularization can be applied like this. Next, we create a decoder using a 2D transposed convolutional layer and a 2D convolutional layer. Create a model for training. Additionally, we create a model to obtain the outputs of the encoder, and then compile the model for training. We use binary cross-entropy loss. Fit this model to the training data. Let's take a visual look at the history of training and test losses. During training, the training error and the test error are reduced like this. Finally, let's visually check the encoder's outputs for 10 test data points. We input 10 test data points into the encoder model and get the output values. The shape of the encoder output is 10 by 28 by 28 by 10. The first dimension 10 is the number of test data points. And the last 10 is the number of filters in the encoder output layer. Visualize 10 test data points. The results are as follows. And we visualize the encoder outputs for the 10 test data points. The results are as follows. These are the images generated by each filter for digit 6. And these are the images generated by each filter for digit 9. White pixels have values close to 1, and black pixels have values close to 0. White pixels are the edges of the digit image. We can see that the encoder model learns to detect edges in the input image. Edge detection plays an important role in image pattern recognition. Sparse autoencoders can be useful for such tasks. If we plot the pixel values of this image as a 3D bar chart, it would look like this. You can see that the pixel values at the edges of the digit image are larger, and the pixel values at the inside are smaller. Next, let's observe the results of a standard autoencoder without the sparsity constraint. For some filters, edges are detected, but overall, no edges are detected. That is, the pixel values are not sparse. Let's run this code. We got the following results. So far, we have looked at a sparse autoencoder and used it to detect edges in MNIST images. In the next video, we will look at anomaly detection using an autoencoder.